Good morning to all. Today we will discuss third unit of engineering thermodynamics, second law of thermodynamics. Earlier we introduced the vocabulary and work, heat, and how the heat transfer is taking place. In the first unit we discussed next first law of thermodynamics, its application in flow process, non-flow process we discussed. Now today we will discuss about second law of thermodynamics. In that what syllabus we are covering is first statements of second law of thermodynamics. Based on the statements, we are constructing heat engine and heat pump, then working principle of heat engine and heat pump, and what is the difference, and the statements equivalency and perpetual motion machine of second guide, and Carnot cycle, and what is the Carnot theorem, why Carnot cycle is practically not feasible, and some problems we will solve. This is a brief syllabus we will discuss in next 1 hour class. First of all, what are the limitations of first law of thermodynamics? First law of thermodynamics is giving energy balance. There is no directional feasibility. Just energy in equal to energy out. Equality we are giving means in both way it can execute. There is no limitation, directional feasibility. Like that I placed a hot cup of coffee outside atmosphere, means it will cool, but it will not heat. It can't extract the heat from the outside, and further heating of the coffee will not take place. But first law is not mentioned, like resistance. We are supplying electrical energy, it will produce heat, but we are supplying heat to the resistor, means it will not generate the electrical energy. Like that pedestal wheel, it is rotating, it generates heat. Internal energy is increasing. If I am reducing the internal energy, it cannot produce the work. So directional feasibility is the first constraint of the first law of thermodynamics. Second constraint is quality. In the thermodynamics, heat equal to work, they are telling. But heat is not equal to work. Heat is low grade energy, work is high grade energy. So the quality, once quality is coming to the picture, then degradation of energy also coming to the picture. First law not discusses that quality. So even though if we are accepted, it is accepted to the first law of thermodynamics, the system may feasible or may not. So first of all, we want to decide whether the process is possible or not. What we are doing, first we are applying second law of thermodynamics. If it is satisfied, then we will move to the first law of thermodynamics, designing of individual components. In the all spontaneous process in the nature occurs only one direction. That is, we want to recall ourselves. Any process, spontaneous process, are occur in nature only one direction. In other direction, the spontaneity will not occur unless otherwise you are not spending some energy. That we want to recall. So the main importance, one is directional feasibility, second quality. We are discussing in second law of thermodynamics. Next, in the second law of thermodynamics, one more vocabulary we are introduced, that is thermal reservoir. Reservoir will know kept large volumes of mass or energy, water, large volumes we are storing is called reservoir. But in thermodynamics, reservoir is not large volume storing, it's a hypothetical one. Even though we are extracting continuously, or we are giving continuously, the temperature of the reservoir is not changing, that is called thermal reservoir. But generally we are continuously extracting or continuously giving, automatically temperature will change. But for simplification of the problems, we are assuming one hypothetical one, that is called thermal reservoir. The heat capacity is not changing even though we are continuously, suppose three-cylinder reservoir is there, continuously we are removing the water, after some time 210 TMC of the water, it will come to 40 TMC or 50 TMC. Continuation we are removing, but here our assumption there is no change. Example, at least any hypothetical examples are there, means best example, we are rejecting heat to the ambient. In a winters we are rejecting room heat to the ambient. Ambient temperature is not increasing that much, or we are switch on the TV, electronic goods, gadgets. We are nearer the electronic gadget, we will face some heat is generating. But inside the room temperature almost it is not changing. So this is called low temperature reservoir, this is called sink. Continuously it is absorbing heat. Suppose high temperature reservoirs like furnace, we are using for melting of the metal or preparation of different types of the gadgets, whatever the furnace we are using, casting purpose and all. Their continuation, one single temperature furnace is maintained, 900 degrees. It's a source. High temperature means continuously rejecting heat. Continuously we are extracting the heat from the reservoir, then it is called source. From sun also, sun temperature 5400 Kelvin around. Continuously we are extracting heat from the sun. Sun temperature is not changing. So some of the examples. So source and sink. Then what is the engine? Engine is just energy conversion device. You are converting any energy one form to another form, means it is engine. But coming to the heat engine first it is converting chemical energy to the thermal energy. By utilizing that thermal energy, we are producing mechanical work. We know what is mechanical work, rotation of the shaft. That rotation of shaft directly connected to the pulleys, it will lift the or lowering of the load, or it will pull the vehicle. Otherwise, we are connected to the generator, it will generate the electrical energy by creation of the potential difference. Energy transfer will take place. But heat engine means it is a special device. First, it is converting chemical energy to the thermal energy. By utilizing that thermal energy, we are producing the mechanical. Heat engines are different types, maybe external combustion and internal combustion. Maybe different types is there, but common characters are there for heat engine. Heat engines, it must be receive heat from the high temperature source. Part of heat is converted to the work. Remaining heat must be rejected to the sink, and it must be operate on cycle. Any engine is not operating on cycle means it is not heat engine. Next, the mediator for operation of this, whatever the mediator we are using, that mediator is called working fluid. In examination, explain heat engine means we can't write characters of the heat engine. You select any heat engine, it may be internal combustion engine, it may be external combustion engine. You explain the cyclic operation. You see, I selected external combustion engine because we can visualize the all characters, where heat attraction, extraction is there, where part of heat is converted as work, and remaining heat where it is rejected. You see, this is the steam power plants, Rankine cycle based steam power plants. We selected this one. You can see pump, boiler, turbine and condenser. In boiler, we are giving the heat continuously from the external source by the burning of the fossil fuel, nuclear reaction, by the solar energy, any one form. Continuously, we are extracting heat from the source. Here we are generating steam. The steam is expanding and generating some work. Part of heat is converted as a work in turbine. Then whatever the low pressure steam is there, we are condensing in condenser. Heat rejection is take place in the condenser. So some part of the heat is rejected. Then by using the pump, this low pressure liquid is pumped to the boiler. This is the cyclic operation. So it is fulfilling all needs. Heat extracted from high temperature source, part of it is converted as a work, remaining it is rejected to the sink. What is thermal efficiency? The fraction of heat supply is converted as a work. How much fraction of heat is converted as a work is called thermal efficiency. Simple. You see, thermal efficiency equal to net work output by heat supply. In thermodynamics title itself, heat to work, heat to power. So the equation indicates how efficient the amount of heat supplied to an engine is converted into work. Why I selected this steam power plant means, you can see in India itself 62% of the thermal power, total electrical energy generation by the thermal power plants only. This Rankine cycle steam thermal power plants only. So it is most useful cycle. We are discussing in applied thermodynamics thoroughly. Now just the function only we discussed in this unit. Next, what is Kelvin-Planck statement? First we discussed engine, then we are moved to the statement. Heat is flowing from high temperature to low temperature. If you are creating temperature gradient, automatically heat transfer will take place. While it is transferring, in between I place one engine, then it will produce some work. Like from reservoirs, where water is flowing, in between water flow I placed one turbine, automatically it will generate the electrical energy. If water is not flowing, then we can't generate any electrical energy. simple logic. So here, suppose according to thermal efficiency, what is the how much fraction of the heat is converted as a work? No doubt. Now I want to assume 100% efficiency. When I will get 100% efficiency, heat rejection is zero. Heat rejection is zero, then only I will get 100% efficiency. Is it practically feasible? So heat rejection is zero, then only we will get the 100% efficiency. Then we will reconstruct that heat engine. It is continuously extracting the heat at single reservoir, then only we will get the efficiency of 100%. What Kelvin Planck is mentioned? Why? Because single reservoir means there is no temperature gradient. If there is no temperature gradient, how heat will flow? If heat is not flowing, how the engine is converted as a that part of it to work? That's a question mark. So what is the Kelvin Planck statement means? It is impossible to construct a reversible cycle engine which produces work continuously by sharing heat with single fixed temperature reservoir. Single fixed temperature reservoir, based on single fixed temperature reservoir, we cannot construct heat engine. Heat engine cannot work. Why? Because without temperature gradient, heat will not flow. If heat is not flowing, how we will convert part of it to work? Or simply we can write Kelvin Planck statement in a thumb rule like that. 100% efficiency of heat engine practically not possible. Energy conversion device. Next, same thing. What is the Clausius statement? Heat is flowing from high temperature to low temperature, but I want to transfer heat from low temperature to high temperature. What is the next against nature? Means for the storage of the perishable goods, for human comfort. We want to extract the heat from low temperature and reject to the high temperature scene. That is our target. So for that operation, you want to spend some energy through a device. Without device I am spending energy, there is no use. Through a device you want to spend some energy, then only heat can transfer low temperature to high temperature. Energy transfer. Clausius statement, it is covering energy transfer. Kelvin Planck statement, energy conversion. You want to. So what is the statement? Heat cannot flow of itself from low temperature body to high temperature body without any effect on the surroundings. Work must be spent to do so. We want to spend some work through some device. That is called Clausius statement. So based on the Clausius statement, refrigerators and heat pumps are designed. So refrigerator and heat pump, both components are same. Vapor compression refrigeration system, vapor absorption refrigeration system. See, different systems are there. Commercially available one, vapor compression refrigeration cycle. We will discuss one cycle. First of all, how these refrigerators or heat pumps are working means, simple. We know the gas law, PV equal to MRT. V by M. Why? Because in the cycle, whatever the mediator we are selecting in refrigeration and heat pump is called refrigerator. That specific volume is fixed. We are not changing. 1 liter I selected means 1 liter only rotating inside the cycle. Next, if I am increasing pressure, temperature will increase. I am decreasing pressure, temperature will decrease. That's all. Simple principle. Whenever I want to reject the heat, I am rising the temperature. Why? Because more than ambient condition only, we can reject the heat. Whenever I want to absorb the heat, my temperature is less than the ambient, then only it can absorb the heat. Then we are reducing the pressure. So, we are increasing, decreasing the pressure for achievement of the desired temperatures. That's all. First working principle of any refrigeration and air conditioning system. That's why I ran this equation. So this refrigeration or heat pump, vapor compression refrigeration system contains components, evaporator, compressor, condenser and expansion valve. This evaporator, we all know, we will visualize refrigerator. Deep freezer is a evaporator. There absorption of heat is taking place. And compressor is outside down, it is one seamless compressor is one. Is available in the back side of the refrigerator. Next, condenser. We know mesh type structure is there. This is called condenser. Next, expansion wall or total wall or capillary tube, one bunch of the pipe, small size pipe is available in backside of the near compressor. Okay, these are the components. Just visualize your refrigerator, then I will explain the working principle. In evaporator, it is absorbing the heat. QL of the heat, it is absorbed in the evaporator. Very good. After absorption, it want to reject the heat. Why? Because same refrigerant we are using in our cycle. Again, I want to use the same refrigerant, means it want to reject the heat. But at low temperature, it cannot reject the heat. By the absorption of the heat, liquid will convert as a vapor. That vapor having low temperature, it cannot reject the heat. What we are doing, same natural gas law, we are increasing the pressure by using the compressor. This vapor is compressed by the compressor. Up to what pressure we are compressing? The refrigerant temperatures reaching more than ambient condition. You see, 60 degrees temperature. Maximum ambient temperatures will reach 45. So more than ambient, we are compressing the refrigerant. Then this high pressure, high temperature vapor, it move to the condenser. It is rejecting the heat and it will convert as a liquid. This liquid also available at ambient temperature only. But we want the evaporator temperature minus 5 degrees like that, minus 25, to achieve minus 15 to minus 5 degrees temperature in the evaporator. You want to maintain refrigerator temperature is minus 25. Then what we are doing, instead of placing turbine, why? Because liquid expansion, it will produce very, very less power compared to vapor compression. So we replaced the turbine and placed the expansion wall or total wall or capillary tube based on the capacity it is changing. What is its function means? The heat value, enthalpy is not changing, isoenthalpy process. Without changing enthalpy, we are reducing the pressure for attainment of low temperatures. That's all. For attainment of low temperatures. Again, low temperature, liquid, low pressure liquid enter into the evaporator. It is a continuation operation. Then the refrigerator or heat pump, both are the transfer of heat from low temperature to high temperature only. But our desired effect is heating, then it is called heat pump. Our desired effect is cooling, then it is called refrigerator. Suppose refrigerator, coefficient of performance of refrigerator means desired output by required input. Then QL by W net, heat supply minus heat rejection, QH minus QL, W net. So in condenser, how much of heat I am rejecting means QL of heat I absorbed in the evaporator. QL of heat I absorbed in the evaporator and some work I supplied. For which purpose I supplied some work? To raise the temperature only. It is converted as heat only. So this QL and W net combinedly we are rejecting the condenser. So how much of work network input is required means QH minus QL only the network input. That is only we write the equation QH minus QL. Suppose heat pump. Same heat pump function also same. Then desired effect is heating QH by QH minus QL. Then COP of heat pump equal to COP of refrigeration plus 1. We can derive this one automatically we will get. So COP of heat pump 100% higher than the COP of refrigerant. So this CO, the heat pump efficiency minimum is 100. Minimum is 100, always we will get more than 100. So one question we'll discuss. What happens when you leave your fridge door open in the kitchen? It will cool the room or heat the room? It's a common question in any interviews in thermal side they will ask. If I open the fridge door, it will heat the room or cool the room? So for closing this one problem will solve. QL, heat removal at evaporator is 50 kilojoules. Heat rejection at condenser is 60 kilojoules. Then determine the COP of refrigeration and the COP of heat pump. Desired effect by heat supply minus QH minus QL. then 50 by 60 minus 50, the net work done is 10 kilojoules, 50 by 10, 5, COP of heat pump 60 by 10, 6, COP of heat pump equal to COP of refrigeration plus 1. So then we will move. So here in refrigerator, they ask a question. Refrigerator is available inside the room. Once you open the fridge door, means it will act as a refrigerator and it will act as a heat pump also. Condenser also available in the room. But heat pump efficiency is 100% higher than the refrigerator. Automatically, it will heat the room, not cool the room. Next, difference between the heat engine and heat pump. Heat engine is energy conversion device. Heat pump is energy transfer device. Here performance thermal efficiency of the any engine we are measuring net work output by heat input and thermal efficiency is maximum less than 100. But coming to the heat pump, the COP of heat pump is minimum 100. Why we are calling COP, especially in refrigeration and air conditioning? So, first energy, heat engine is energy conversion device, heat pump is energy transfer device. So, energy transfer device will get more than 100% efficiency, but universally efficiency means 100 only. That's why we given energy transfer devices efficient performance measurement by coefficient of performance, COP. Everywhere we are using any, wherever energy transfer is coming to the picture, we are calling COP. Next, perpetual motion machine. It's a violation of thermodynamic law. First law violation already we discussed in last unit. Just I am recalling. Here, they consider the team considered direct, that is steam power plant only. But here, up to reaching steady state, we are supplying heat from the external source. Then after, part of the electrical energy we are supplying by using resistance to the boiler for generation of the steam. Then the energy balance, you see, without input energy, we are producing the net work output and heat rejection. According to thermodynamic first law, you are supplying some energy, maximum you will get that much of energy, or some accumulation of energy will take place. But here, without input, continuously it is producing, it is practically not feasible. That same scientist group accepted, without input we cannot produce output. Then they proposed second type of perpetual motion machine of second kind. What they proposed, you see, same Rankine cycle engine they considered, but they removed the condenser. Why? Because heat loss in condenser around 60%. So if you remove the condenser, means automatically whatever the heat we supplied in boiler, totally it will convert as a work. There is no loss to the condenser. This is the assumption. But what second law of the thermodynamic statement, Kelvin-Planck statement, we cannot construct heat engine with single reservoir. Because two reservoirs are required, then only heat flow will take place. In between I placed one engine, then it will convert part of it to work. So this one also practically not feasible. So why we are explaining this perpetual motion machine 1 or 2 means minimum energy balance is required while we are designing system or proposing the process. If it is not satisfying minimum energy balance, it is practically not feasible. Don't waste our valuable time for this designings. For that reason only, every time while we are discussing thermodynamics means we are explaining perpetual motion machine 1 and 2. Next, equivalence of the Kelvin-Planck and Clausius statement. Why? Because Kelvin-Planck statement energy conversion device. Clausius is energy transfer device. Both statements are different. But if both are equal, we want to prove that one. Because if we violated Kelvin-Planck statement, means it's also violation of Clausius statement. How it is, you can see, I constructed one heat engine, heat pump combined system operating between same temperature limit. Source temperature is TH, sink temperature is TL. In heat engine, what I assumed, it is 100% efficiency, means violation of Kelvin-Planck statement. There is no heat rejection to the lower temperature sink. So total heat is converted as a work. That work we are supplying refrigerator to transfer of QL heat to the high temperature source. So the W net equal to QH, then how much of refrigerator, how much of heat is rejecting at a high temperature source? This W net plus QL. W net means 100% efficiency means QH plus QL. So I violated Kelvin Planck statement. I constructed a combination of heat engine and refrigerator. Then you see the final figure, the combination figure. You are extracting QH of heat and you are rejecting QH plus QL. The net rejection is QL. So the net rejection is QL. How much heat is transferring? QL heat. So refrigerator is transferring QL heat without any input. So if I violated Kelvin Planck statement, is also violation of class A statement. What is class A statement mentioned? To transfer of heat from low temperature to high temperature, we want to spend some energy, but here in the construction you see we are not spending any energy. So it's a violation of class A statement. So if we violated Kelvin Planck statement, means it's also violation of class A statement. That's next, reversibility and irreversibility. When we will get the reversibility, infinite equilibrium steps we are taking, infinite equilibrium steps we are taking to complete the process state 1 to state 2, then only we will get the reversibility. But in all practical process are finite steps you are taking and all are irreversible only. We know all are irreversible. What are the causes of irreversibility is required? At least we know the causes of irreversibility. We can reduce the irreversibility. Then we can achieve the more efficiency. First one, friction. We all know. Because by movement of any body, friction is generated and heat is dissipated to the surrounding. We cannot regain the that heat. You can see. Best example. Next, free expansion. In vacuum I created, I separated by the membrane. Once membrane is removed, total gas freely will expand. Again we want to compress, means we want to create the vacuum, means again you want to use the vacuum pump, you want to spend some energy. Or heat transfer through the finite temperature difference. I placed a hot cup of coffee outside the atmosphere, automatically it will cool. But we cannot extract the heat to regain of the coffee temperature. We want to spend some energy. It is also irreversible one. And mixing of two different substances also irreversible only. Nitrogen, oxygen, I mix as a air. But separation of nitrogen, oxygen, practically it will consume more energy. So these are some irreversible process. Next unit we will derive the equations also for this irreversibility. Generally reversibility, internal reversible and external reversible. Internal means within the system we are getting the reversibility, then it is called internal reversible, like all quasi static process. But external reversible means with the reservoir, whatever assumption I made in starting of the lecture, I mentioned thermal reservoir we are assuming at constant temperature, constant heat capacity, continuously we are extracting heat. If we are extracting continuously without changing the temperature, without changing the heat value, then it is called external reversible. So with the surrounding we are capable to achieve the reversibility, then it is external reversible. Within the system we can get the reversibility, then it is called internal reversible. Generally simple reversible or total reversible means it is a internal plus external reversible or total reversible. The next topic is a Carnot cycle. It is the first cycle, reversible cycle for power generation. It is proposed in 1824, French engineer. So he is not scientist. If scientist is proposed, means he will give cycle, number of process, and he will give some derivations. But he is engineer. He proposed the engine also, how the engine construction and how the engine will work also. He proposed. Now we will discuss that one. You see, one cylindrical block he considered. The block piston is moving with no friction, that is his assumption. And head is covered by two types of the covers, adiabatic cover and diathermic cover. So while adiabatic cover means there is no heat transfer. Whenever no heat transfer is required, head is replaced by the adiabatic cover. If heat transfer is required, diathermic cover is replacing. and this head and piston in between place is covered by some fluids, any type of fluid you can select. So what are the cycle proposal? He considered two process, one is isothermal, second one is adiabatic. Suppose we will start 1 to 2 reversible isothermal heat addition. So in this operation, first he will replace adiabatic cover by diathermic cover and he will supply the heat constant temperature. Then this fluid liquid will convert as a vapor, then change in volume will occur. While we are supplying heat, the change in volume is it is producing work only. In isothermal process we already derived the equations. Total heat will convert as a work, there is no change in energy. So in isothermal process total heat will convert as a work, there is no accumulation of energy. So that's why he selected isothermal. So piston is moving, while we are supplying heat also work is producing. Then 2 to 3 reversible adiabatic expansion. In this operation this diathermic cover is replaced by adiabatic cover. Then whatever the change in internal energy of the fluid is there, that change in internal energy will convert as a work, there is no heat loss. That is the adiabatic process. Then at the end of the adiabatic process, piston will reach from TDC to BDC. So my expansion process will complete. In isothermal heat addition expansion is taking place and adiabatic process also expansion is taking place. Next, 3 to 4 reversible isothermal heat rejection. In this operation again diathermic cover is replaced by adiabatic cover. Adiabatic cover is replaced by diathermic cover and heat rejection will take place. Due to the heat rejection, these vapors are condensed to the liquid. Again compression. So compression will initiate up to some heat rejection point. Then after reversible adiabatic compression, then this diathermic cover again replaced by adiabatic cover and further compression of the liquid for reaching of the initial state. Why? Because it's a cyclic operation, for reaching of the initial state from the external source. So this is the cyclic operation. He selected very good cycle, very good process. One process is heat, total heat will convert as a work. Second process is there is no heat loss, total change in energy will convert as a work. Same represented as a separately, that is not required. This is the explanation. Then efficiency of the Carnot cycle, we know part of heat is converted as a work. Heat is directly proportional to temperature, then we will get 1 minus sink temperature by source temperature. What is Carnot theorems by the cycles? Any reversible heat engine cycle operating between same reservoir temperatures, means source and sink temperature, efficiencies are same. Because all are part of heat converted as a work, heat is directly proportional to temperature, reservoir temperature same, cycle efficiency is same. And Carnot cycle, especially Carnot cycle engine efficiency is independent of working medium. We are not discussed any working medium. So it is independent of working medium. It is only depend on source and sink temperature. That's all. And third one, any real engine efficiency cannot be more than Carnot cycle engine. These are the three findings. This much of very good cycle, why it is not practically feasible? One thing, first assumption, all processes are reversible. In a practical case, all are irreversible. And second case, you see, for the four process, every time I want to replace the head cover, one time diathermic cover, one time adiabatic cover, generally for getting 50 hertz frequency of the electrical energy, at least engine speed is required 1500 rpm. Means for minute 1500 cycles, for how many processes? 4, 1500 to 4, 6000. Times I want to replace the adiabatic and diathermic covers per minute. Is it practically feasible? So that is the one drawback. And third one, it contains isothermal process, very good process, but it will time consumption. Change the phase, it will consume more time. So very slow process. At that time, for isothermal time, piston will move very slowly. Coming to the adiabatic, there is no heat loss. When you will get no heat loss, it is a too fast process. So as at the time of adiabatic isothermal, engine will move slowly, Once it moves to the adiabatic, it will move fast. Within the cycle, two frequencies is not acceptable. And third one, engine has, say, for the same power output, have the long stroke length. You see, for the heat supply, expansion is taking place. For work done, expansion is taking place. For the same work output, stroke length is high, means the stroke volume is high, self weight of the engine is high. Automatically, whatever the energy it is generating, it is used for to pull the self weight itself, it will take place. These are the some of the drawbacks. Because of that only, Carnot cycle practically not feasible. And some problem, this is a common problem in competition exams. We are using this relation. You should read the problem. A reversible engine operating between temperature T1 and T, the engine rejected from this engine is received by a second reversible engine at the same temperature T. The second engine rejects energy at the temperature 2. So indirectly two engines are connected series. I will show the figure. Two engines connected in series. One engine rejection is second engine source. One engine sink is second engine source. Okay, this is the construction. So initially T1 is the source. Final sink temperature is T2. Intermediate temperature is T. What we want to derive? First one, temperature T is the arithmetic mean temperature of T1, T2. When we will get the arithmetic? If the engine produces the same amount of work outputs. If engine produce, so if two engines work output is same, then the intermediate temperature is arithmetic mean temperature of T initial and final. We want to prove that. But we are deriving this one, we want to recall this one. This equation we can use for solving the problems in competition exam, especially in GATE. So same work output means heat input minus heat rejection, Q1 minus Q2 equal to, here second engine heat input is Q3 minus Q4, Q is directly proportional temperature, Q1 directly proportional T1, Q2 is directly proportional T, and Q3 is directly proportional T only, why? Because same temperature source, and Q4 is directly proportional to T2. Then you see T1 minus T equal to T minus T2, T equal to T1 plus T2 by 2. So we will get the arithmetic. Second one. Temperature T is the geometric mean of the temperatures T1 and T2 if the engines have the same cycle efficiency. So T is the geometric mean of the temperature of T1 T2 if the engine has same efficiency. Here same work done means arithmetic mean. If same efficiency, same equation, 1 minus T by T1 equal to 1 minus T2 by TR, T by T1 equal to T2 by TR, T square is equal to T1 T2 and T equal to square root of T1, T2. So, simple. Two engines constructed in series. The intermediate temperature, if both engines work output is same, it is produced same work output, then intermediate temperature equal to arithmetic mean temperature of initial and final. If both engines are producing same efficiency, then the intermediate temperature equal to geometric mean of initial and final temperature. That's all. Two relations. Next, one more problem. A heat engine receives heat at the rate of 1500 kilojoules per minute and gives an output of 8.2 kilowatt. Determine the thermal efficiency, the rate of heat rejection. Here, simple direct question, but heat input they are given kilojoules per minute, convert it to kilojoules per second. That's all, 1500 divided by 60. In this problem, I converted joules per second. You can stop kilojoules per second, so there is no issue. Work already given 8.2 kilowatt or kilojoules per second. Then thermal efficiency, net work output by heat input, we get 32.8. Then work done equal to heat supply minus heat rejection. Work done already we know 8.2, heat supply we know 25, finally we will get 16.8 kilojoules per second. And one more problem. A cyclic heat engine operating between a source temperature of 800 degree centigrade and sink temperature of 30 degree centigrade. What is the rate of heat rejection per kilowatt net output of the engine? So here indirectly they given per kilowatt. So work output is 1 kilowatt. Indirectly they provided. And source temperature they given, sink temperature they given, convert into Kelvin scale 800 plus 273, 30 plus 273. Substitute, determine the efficiency of the engine 71.76. And heat input first calculate 1.39 kilowatt because efficiency we know, and work output for 1 kilowatt power output we want to determine. 1 kilowatt power output, how much heat input is required? 1.39 kilowatt is required. Then what is the heat rejection? Net work output equal to heat input minus heat rejection, or heat rejection equal to heat input minus net work output. 1.39 minus 1 we will get 0.39 kilowatt. Next one, N. So an investigator claims to have developed an engine that takes place in 105 megajoules at a temperature of 400 Kelvin, rejects 42 megajoules at the temperature of 200 Kelvin. So rejection heat they given 42 megajoules, and how much heat is extracting also they given 105 megajoules, and operating temperatures 400 Kelvin and the rejection temperature is 200 Kelvin. They given the heat input, heat rejection and source temperature and sink temperature, and delivers 15 kilowatt hour of mechanical work. It's a work production also they given, net work output also given, but in the form of kilowatt hour. Convert into kilojoules, 15 into 3600 kilojoules divided by megajoules we want to convert, divided by 1000 you will get the megajoules of mechanical work. Would you advise investing money to put this engine in the market? So we already discussed that. If any heat engine efficiency is higher than Carnot cycle efficiency, then it is not practically feasible. So first we are calculating the Carnot cycle efficiency, then we are determining the engine efficiency. That efficiency is higher than Carnot cycle, automatically it is, we can refuse the proposal. Then you can see, first Carnot cycle efficiency we determined 1 minus 200 by 400, 50%. If net work output equal to heat supply minus heat rejection by heat supply, then we will get 60% efficiency. Or actual net work output they gave given in the problem itself, 15 kilowatt hour, 15 into 3600 divided by 1000, why we are writing is to convert into megajoules. Why? Because heat supply in megajoules divided by 1000 divided by 105 will get 51.43. Carnot cycle efficiency 50, actual engine efficiency is 51.40. So it is practically, it is not feasible. We can refuse the proposal. Like that same problem, we can solve yourself. Here temperature range they given, determine the Carnot efficiency. Then heat input they are not given directly, mass flow rate they given, 3.9 kg per hour burning. And heat value they given, so convert into per second divided by 60 into 60. Power output they given 75 kilowatt. Then you substitute the efficiency, actual engine efficiency we are getting 92.95, but Carnot cycle efficiency only 70.86. It's above the Carnot cycle, so the proposal is not valid. Like these problems, especially in competition exams, you can expect. Next problem, a cyclic power plant operates in the Carnot cycle between the heat reservoirs at temperature 500 Kelvin and 300 Kelvin respectively. So one heat engine is working 500 Kelvin and 300 Kelvin. So this is the construction, heat engine 500 Kelvin and 300 Kelvin. Next, the work output of this device is used to provide the work input of a reversible heat pump. So whatever the work output we are producing from the heat engine, it is indirectly we are giving total work output to the work input of the heat pump only. For which purpose? to transfer, heat pump is working on the reservoir in between the temperature limits 290 Kelvin to 300. So to transfer the heat from 219 Kelvin to the 300 Kelvin, heat pump is working. For that heat pump working, we are generating whatever the heat engine generating network, the total network we are supplying to the heat pump. This is the construction. So first, once we read the problem is, first draw the figure, clear schematic view. So heat engine is working 500 Kelvin and 300 Kelvin, show the error marks. Heat is coming from high temperature to low temperature. Then whatever the heat engine is producing, network output of the heat engine is work input of heat pump, whatever it is producing, that is second. And second one, heat pump, what it is doing, it is extracting heat from 290 Kelvin. You see arrow mark, 290 Kelvin is the least temperature, T4. It is extracting the heat from 290 Kelvin and rejecting that heat at 300 Kelvin. Then calculate the ratio of heat delivered in each cycle to the high temperature reservoir of heat pump. So heat pump high temperature reservoir, what is there? 300 Kelvin only. So how much of heat we are rejecting by heat pump and by heat engine? Heat pump high temperature reservoir means 300 Kelvin reservoir. Heat engine sink also 300 Kelvin only. So Q3 of the heat we are rejecting and Q2 of heat by heat engine we are rejecting. So how much heat is rejecting at 300 Kelvin means Q3 plus Q2. Calculate the ratio of heat delivered in each cycle to the high temperature reservoir of the heat pump to the extraction in each cycle from the high temperature reservoir of the power plant. The power plant high temperature reservoir, what is the temperature? It is a 500 Kelvin temperature. So the power plant is extracting how much heat? Q1 heat. So I want to determine the ratio of Q2 plus Q3 by Q1. That's all. For that he is not given any heat values. Only operating temperatures they provided. Heat engine operating temperatures is 500 Kelvin and 300 Kelvin. And heat pump operating temperatures is 290 Kelvin and 300 Kelvin. Then you see, first efficiency of the heat engine, network output by heat input R1 minus Q2 by Q1, R1 minus T2 by T1, then efficiency of heat engine is 0.40. Then Q2 by Q1, you can write 1 minus efficiency, then 0.60. So one ratio we know, Q2 by Q1 is 0.60. Next, work, network by heat input is equal to efficiency, then work output is 0.40 of heat input. That's all. 40% efficiency means 40% of the heat input will convert as a net work output. One more relation we got. Next, COP of heat pump, we know desired effect is a Q3 divided by Q3 minus Q4, the heat rejection at the source minus sink. The difference only the network input. Network input equal to Q3 minus Q4, Q3 minus Q4, and desired effect is Q3, not Q4. Why? Because it is a heat pump. If it is a refrigerator, desired effect is Q4. Then Q3 by Q3 minus Q4, T3 by T3 minus T4, determine the COP of heat pump is 30. So COP of heat pump is equal to Q3 by W net. W net we know how much? Because whatever the heat engine is generating the energy, total energy we are supplying to the heat pump to transfer of the heat from low temperature sink to the high temperature source. So Q3 equal to COP of heat pump into W net. W net we know 0.40 Q1. COP of heat pump is 30, then 12 Q1. Okay. So Q3 equal to 12 Q1 or Q3 by Q1 equal to 12. So one more ratio. Earlier one ratio is there, Q2 by Q1 equal to 0.60, Q3 by Q1 equal to 12. Then heat transfer to the high temperature reservoir of heat pump is Q2 plus Q3 and heat transfer from the reservoir of the power plant is Q1. Then Q2 plus Q3 by Q1, we want to determine the ratio only, the ratio of heat delivered high temperature of heat pump to the heat extracted from the power plant.
each engine.
Q2 plus Q3 by Q1 or Q2 by Q1 plus Q3 by Q1. Q2 by Q1 is 0.60 and second one Q3 by Q1 is 12. So we will get 12.60. This is the heat ratios. So some of the problems only I solved. Overall, we discussed the statements and equivalency of the statements and difference between heat engine and heat pump. The major difference of heat engine and heat pump is heat engine is energy conversion device, not energy generation. According to first law of thermodynamics, energy neither created nor destroyed. It can change one form to another form. So heat engine working is to convert the energy one form to another form. And heat pump working means energy transfer device. One temperature to another temperature, we are transferring the energy. That's the main difference between heat engine and heat pump. I think with this I am ending the brief revision of second law of thermodynamics. Next we will move to the entropy and the reversibility in next lectures. Thank you very much.